So while Andrew's getting set up, because my Mac didn't actually work as well. So this isn't a technical talk. So if you were hoping for something technical, then sorry, you've missed out. I know some of you are giving up very technical talks about because we clashed with the Microsoft Cloud meetup tonight and also the OpenShift meetup. So feel free to run out now, okay? So I won't be disappointed, Norman. You can just leave.
So, I'm committed.
You're committed. So I guess the headline, well, the headline of this talk is, so you want to be a DevOps engineer. This talk is actually probably over 12 months in the making, but you won't recognise that from the poorly rushed together slides this morning. Mostly because life has gotten away from me, so when I originally proposed the talk, my wife was about to give birth, so my son's 1 year old next week. So.
Couldn't automate that?
Sorry?
You couldn't automate that?
It's just a PDF on the same machine. It's technical difficulties. So I'm reading off my notes because I'm old and I can't do anything but do that. So. I actually started out my career. Not too many people probably know where I come from, my background is, unless you know me really well. I started out working for these guys. Anyone have any idea who these guys are? You have to shout. Yes. So I started out in my life there as a radio technician. So it's some time ago. Sorry, I'm not used to having to speak in the microphone
because I actually do have a loud booming voice. So
I'm trying to temper it down a little bit while I've got this. So so that's where I started my career. Interestingly enough, bear with me while I draw this long parallel. So to work on an aeroplane, I needed a radio technician. You needed an instrument fitter, you needed an electrician, you needed an armament fitter, so you needed guys that knew engines, you needed guys that knew airframes. There was at least three, what we call four white-hander trades, so they were electrical, electronic type trades. And so if you had a problem with a radio, and you thought, well, actually, there's not a problem with the radio, it's a problem with the gauge. You had to go and get the instrument fitter, and he had to come along and look at the gauges, and he'd say, no, there's nothing wrong with them. You have to get the electrician, it'll be a wiring problem. And he'd come along and he'd look at them, and they'd go, it's not my problem, it's your problem. So I'm sure you could draw some very similar parallels. So what did the Air Force do? They come up with these things called avionics technicians. So that meant they could work on instruments, they could work on electricals, they could work on anything that was electrical related. They could even work on the bombs, because the bomb, turns out, is just pretty similar to the airplane. It's just got a big explosive bit at the back that makes it propel forward, and it's got a shed load of electronics in the middle. Just with missiles, it's got another bigger bang at the end of it. So, basically, there is some sort of parallels here. So often at these talks, it's like, okay, who's this old guy? And what the hell is he going to know about DevOps? Because this is all new. So, the same reasons that you'll probably want to listen to me are the same reasons that you probably won't want to listen to me. So, I am old. I have been around for a while. I've hired people. I've had a career change. I've had many career changes. So I work in IT now. And as I've just explained to you, I started life as a radio technician. So that's sort of been my background. I'm technical. I also have the word manager in my title. So for you people that are technical, that would relate to wanker, right? So, in the last 15 years, I've had 10 different jobs. So you probably think, shit, this guy can't hold a job either. But I've contracted. So actually, it's probably more like the last 17 years I've had 10 different jobs. So only two of those jobs I found through agencies. Do we have any recruiters in the audience tonight? One, agency recruiter or company? Agency recruiter, cool. Because I'm going to call on you to maybe give me some feedback. I've only got one. I'm gutted. Absolutely gutted. So perhaps you're looking to make a career change, or you know your organisation's changing. You know, Simon from NEC sounds like they're going through a bit of a change. So, or you just want to stay one step ahead, or you want a new job. Hopefully, this will be sort of some insights for you around this talk. So, who is a DevOps engineer in the title? There's a whole bunch of hands before. Can I see you again? Okay, cool, yeah. There was more than that earlier. You're all scared off. Who actually works for a DevOps team? Yeah, cool, okay. So, this isn't me. This is these guys. These guys reportedly know something about DevOps. Having DevOps in your title is actually doing you harm. Dev's humble, there's no such thing as a DevOps team. Okay, so Andrew alluded to the fact that I might actually define what DevOps is. Fat chance. There's two chances of that happening. So right now, you people have put your hand up, even though you just got told you're getting 20% pay rises, you're actually doing yourself harm apparently. Okay, so if that's the case then, so this is just last week, I had a look, you can't really tell that close. So this is a local job searching site some of you may be familiar with. So the keyword DevOps resulted in 529 job posts. The keyword system administrator resulted in 240 posts. In fact, if I actually put Sysadmin in, which is what we generally call ourselves, resulted in single digit figures. Okay, so nearly 20%. So the DevOps survey, it's actually timely because In 2015, in the State of the DevOps Survey, over 20% of the people that replied to that survey identified themselves as DevOps engineers, so strangely enough. So while this term DevOps, DevOps team, DevOps engineer is going to create some controversy, okay, there's absolutely no doubt that it's an important term for you to find a job with, okay, so because see, it tells us so. So what is DevOps role? Well, it's many things to many different people, basically. There's a whole, just thought I'd be artistic, create a word cloud that's good on my resume. I can throw a bunch of words into a website. So it's important that when you look at these adverts for jobs and things like that, that you understand what this person is looking for as in DevOps. So Simon from NEC, he may be looking, his DevOps may mean infrastructure automation. My agency guy over here may mean he actually wants a developer that knows how to run up an AWS stack. So it can be completely different for different people. It may be just about automation, continuous delivery, it may be about testing, it may be about QA, those types of things. There's a whole bunch of reasons. So, trying to give you some tips here, if you want to get a job in this line of work, some of the things that you're going to have to look at. Okay, who here enjoys writing CVs? Two, there was another one over here. There's another one here, three. Okay, are you a professional CV writer? No. Yeah, cool. So who here is good at writing CVs? Oh, yeah, so we've got one down here, another one back here. Looks like there's another one go there. So keep your hands up because I'm going to try and generate you some business. So one of the things that my piece of advice to you is find a professional to help you. So they tell me that the average IT worker in Australia gets around $450 a day. Okay, so I get probably a little bit more than that. I'm hoping, probably I would say, this depends, so that it varies. So how much do you think it's going to cost you to get somebody else to do to write your CV? Would you sacrifice a day of your salary for somebody else to do that for you? Who would do that? Yep. Oh, yeah, a few hands. In fact, turns out it probably only costs you a couple hundred dollars to actually get a professional to do it. Now, they don't magically craft a, you know, from nothing. You have to supply them with information and that type of thing. But what they will do is they will make it modern, current, remove the craft. But, you know, they take out a lot of that, the effort away from you. So, CV is important. So for me, as a hiring manager, you know, it's a first impression type of thing. It may not get you the job, but it's what gets you in the door or through the door. So we've recently had an application that an advert where we posted for a network engineer. We got 140 respondents. So of which out of that, my recruiter has given me 7. Thank God he didn't give me all 140 because I'm even going to struggle to get through the 7. So you need to give me you need to let me know why I should be interested in reading further. So a lot of people, who's got an objective at the top of their CV? One, objectives are out. Okay, so this is, you're old school. So summaries, you know, because we're too busy. Hiring managers are too busy, they're not summaries. So some stuff like that, you know, stuff like that changes. If you get a professional CV, right, he knows that. He knows what things need to be done. He also knows that who got their last job through an agency? You're kidding me. Only 2, 3, 4, I don't believe it. I think there's a whole bunch of people lying. Okay? The majority of people find lots of work through agencies. So you need to know how to play their games. So how your CV is taken in, how it's filtered, where it's put, what keyword searching's done, and the professional CV writers, they know how that works. So that can attract more attention to you. Because as much as I hate to admit it, you know, they've got a tough job. They've got to wade through loads and loads and loads of CVs. They're not only finding this job, but they've probably got, you know, 20 other jobs that they've got on their books. But, you know, and so when you ring up and you say, Joe, did you get my CV? They're kind of like, shit, that's 5 minutes out of my day where I have to go look for this guy, you know? Why didn't it appear in my match? Anyway, okay, because it's a modern era, you're all going to tell me that GitHub is your new resume. Yes, there we go. And I say bullshit. Okay? I say bullshit to your resume on GitHub. This isn't to say that GitHub is not important. It doesn't play an important part in that role. However, there are some of us who have a life when we leave work and that we don't contribute to open source projects. Or we work on stuff that we cannot make public. Absolutely, absolutely, it does, and that'll be one. That. So you're stealing my next. You peaked at the slides, obviously. So I'm not saying it's not important, but you know, it's certainly not your resume because there are things that the other things going on in your life. You may not work for a company that contributes to open source, so you can't share the work that you're doing out. So, but be aware that it does exist. We'll come back to that. Okay. Networking. So LinkedIn's probably the biggest elephant, you know, going around there. You know, that's sort of what I think when I say networking, people think LinkedIn automatically. It's a useful tool. Like any other tool, you should diversify in the use of your tools for your job search. Sadly enough, 14 of my connections have this boy as a first connection, okay? Right? So it's the internet. Not everybody is as they appear to be, okay? Your online girlfriend it's probably a Russian hacker, okay? So sorry for a wake-up call for some of you, I know. Okay, so just, it's worthwhile curating your list. So go through it, go, yeah, actually I don't know these people, or this is a bunch of engineers. Actually, I was going to use another request I got here, but the lady's name was kind of suggestive, and I really wasn't sure whether it was real or not. So I thought for my own sanity, I was going to leave it off. So, and this using your network to find jobs is important because, you know, that there are people here in this room that are hiring. There are people here in this room that are looking for work. So, and getting to know each other beforehand is can be quite an important part if you know that you're going to enjoy, like the DevOps survey show, you know, if you enjoy where you're working and the people that you're working with, then life is much happier. So on average, today, most Gen Ys have, which I'm not one, a job every 2.5 years. So if you're a millennial, any millennials in the group, or you're just not quite pitching young enough, oh yeah, we've got one, you're even worse. You know, my dad had 2 jobs in his entire career, in his life. 2 jobs. I've had more, you know, breakfasts than he's held breakfasts than he's had work. So every 2.5 years, you're likely to be changing jobs. So this is important for you to take your career seriously. So, yeah. So you can expect, you know, to hold somewhere between 20 to 25 jobs over your lifetime. You can actually, has anyone here been made redundant? Well, yes. Actually, there's more people being made redundant than actually got jobs through agencies. I don't believe that. Okay, so I've been made, oh, sorry, I should put my hand up, I've been made redundant as well. So you're actually more like, he's been made redundant twice, yes, 3 times. Look, still got his hand, you're above average achiever. There's 3 times is what you're probably going to get in your career. I'm one, and I just shadowed, I missed out on the second one because I haven't resigned just before it happened. But had I known, I would have hung around and got a package. But, okay, so some of my tips here, short, please, okay. So a very good friend of mine is not in the room tonight. I actually hired him, 14 pages in his resume. Seriously, I'm not reading 14 pages. This is the reason you cannot get a job, my man. You know, you've got to keep it short. Don't let it date you. So there's certain things that it can let it date you. I'm a certified NetWare administrator. Okay? Objectives rather than summaries. outdated technologies and terms. Okay? Just resume trends tend to vary. They vary on countries and those types of things. Add a portfolio. Could be GitHub. So that could be a portfolio of your work. Or that could be, you know, if you're a web developer, we've got any sort of web developers. Yeah. So you guys probably got portfolios of your work, maybe, if you're a UI person, if you're a back-end person, possibly not. But if you're a designer, you might likely have portfolios. No photos. truly, it's not a dating agency. We really don't care what you look like. Okay.
Why?
So. Yeah. You do, so that you can identify them. But these photos are like half a page. Yeah, I have my HR person do that. They grab their LinkedIn photo and stick it on the CV. References will be available on request. Of course they bloody will be. If we want references, we'll ask you. So don't write that. You know, it's like, that is a waste of words and letters. Now, for those of you, you know, like myself, had many years' work, you're finding difficulty in keeping your CV short. So removing that kind of stuff will help you get that short. Oh, I won't use the term CV, everybody understands. Curriculum vitae, resume. I'm in the habit of just using CV. Okay, enough of the resume stuff. Let's have a look at what Facebook is looking for. They're a smart, forward-thinking, upward-wing mobile company. Okay, so what types of things are Facebook looking for? So this is a production engineer. That's as good as any. I'll pick that. Good coders, at least one non-shell language. Okay. So that sounds pretty good. They want Linux systems, TCP IP, distributed systems design, some sort of reliability engineer. Will be on call. Okay. Yes. All right. So that's just a pluck out of what Facebook was looking for. So some of the technical skills that you are going to need. Coding. So I'm basing this exercise from a system admin point of view or an infrastructure type of person. That's my background. So therefore I can speak to that. I'm not a developer, I can't really speak on behalf of that. So go and learn a language. It's what I used to say, I don't really care what you learn. Ruby, Python, Perl, they're all equally as messed up as each other. But actually I do care now. Go and learn Go. Really? And if you really want to know why, go and look at that guy's video. Did anyone went go to LinuxConf 2 weeks ago? No? Anyway, it's recorded. It is less than 20 minutes, and he will tell you why you should be writing your stuff in Go and not in Bash or Ruby or Python. And I agree wholeheartedly with him. Version control. I don't care which one you use. Learn one. Use it. Probably Git, because it is the most popular, despite the fact that I probably prefer you were using Mercurial or something like that, but hey. Yeah. Okay. So it's a bit like VHS and Beta, isn't it? You know? We all know that Beta was better, but we ended up using VHS. My talks are nothing, it's not controversial. So get your stuff up on GitHub. Now, if you go and look at my GitHub account, which is pretty vacant, because most of the time I've worked in organisations where I can't share that stuff and I can't put that up. But I've got some stuff up there, I've got stuff that I've done on the side, other little projects, along the way. Sorry, I just have to consult my notes. Networking. You need to know things like this. You need to know what firewalling is. You need to know what, because security is important. DevOps, State of DevOps report told us it was. Load balancers, TCP IP. You need to get work, you know, you need to get some work in cloud-based environments. Whether we like it or not, Amazon is a $10 billion business, and they are not going anywhere soon. So, not if Jeff Bezos says anything to say that. So, okay. I'm going to take a slide aside. So, these are the things you need to do. So, there's some tech skills. This is real hard core stuff. You can go away and go, yeah, I can do that. That resume stuff, that was a bit fluffy. So, I'm going to take another deviation to fluffy. Get to know your company's application. So, one of the biggest, so I actually went, I was at a gig, I won't name who they were. There's no one here that looks familiar that's in the audience anyway. So I went to the system admin there, and he'd been at this company for 3 years. And I said to the guy, I said, who's the right person I need to go and speak to about this application? And he looked at me and goes, I don't know. He says, I'll just build boxes. Boxes, we have replaced you with a small shell script. If that's all you do, then you know you have been replaced. So unless you want to remain obsolete and stagnant, you need to keep moving. You need to find what your organization's up to. You need to understand your application, because that's where you can add value. So yes, all you sysadmins, I don't want to talk to anyone, heaven forbid. You actually make me go and talk to someone. you need to get out and talk to them. You need to talk to lots and lots of people. You need to understand how your whole application works. Okay. Educate. It's your career. It's not my career. Quite frankly, I couldn't care whether you develop yourself or not. You know, you need to take responsibility for your career. So, you know, I've been on one-on-ones with team members and they've gone, oh yeah, I didn't get this course, or I didn't do this, or I didn't learn this because you didn't give me X, Y, and Z. Actually, it's not really up to me. You know, you need to drive this sort of stuff. And if you're, there are plenty of options. Most of these ones I've listed here, these are all just a variety of online ones that do a whole bunch of online learning type stuff. Now, that may not suit you, or it may suit you. Who here likes sitting in a classroom for 5 days learning? Okay, yeah. There's always a couple of outliers. You kept me in a job for 3 years. I worked as an instructor for some Irish system for 3 years. Did I mention that? So I've worked as an instructor. I fix aeroplanes, I've worked as an instructor, occasionally work on computers. And it's very lucrative for the Sun Microsystems. Yeah, it costs a lot of money. It costs like about $5,000 or $6,000. We used to, that was probably back in 2000. God only knows what it would cost you now to do those courses. So some of these things are way, way cheaper. You can get a subscription to Linux Academy for a year for, I think it was $199 or something like that. It was a discount price. That's US dollars, but you know, and that's all you can eat. And they've got like a shitload of labs and a whole bunch of other stuff. I happen to be one of those people that likes sort of self-paced learning, so I can just go off and do it myself. So I said I'd need 30 minutes. How am I going? Okay, I tend to ramble. All right. You're all up the soft skills. This is the bit where we all fail as technical people. It took me years to master these guys. So this is how we used to do energy drinks. Now it's all, you know, fancy machines and fruit juice and whatever else. You know, that's old school energy drinks. So things you can do then, go to meetups, you're here, so you're taking the first step. Present at meetups. I'm sure Andrew would love for 6 people to volunteer to present. That would cover the year, wouldn't it? So yeah, that would give him 1 a month, and then you'd probably throw in an extra one somewhere along the lines. People would come in. And it doesn't have to be, we're just sharing information. So share your information and learnings with others. So, you know, make connections with people. And we had a discussion earlier when I came in, is like, actually, Company X is building a deployment tool, Company Y is building a deployment tool, and Company Z is also building a deployment tool. And guess what? They're all in CBD Melbourne. You know, we all actually know each other. We're all connected very closely. Write a blog. Why not? Get a mentor. Who here has a mentor? Okay, a couple. Who here is mentoring someone? Cool. More than they're mentoring. So that's a good thing. In fact, it's as much. I'll take some liberty here and say to mentor somebody. I'm not currently doing it at the moment, but previously, it's just as rewarding as being mentored as well. So you can actually learn quite a lot in that process. And it also gets you out and about and talking to people. It's all part of the soft skills. So some people, when they think of this, they go, oh shit, I've got to go to Toastmasters and I've got to do presentations and all that sort of stuff. But you know, presentation doesn't, you don't have to wrap it on like I have. It can be very short. It can just be, hey, we've done this, and we've, you know, in 5 minutes and it's all over. We've had a few of those, I think. Maybe not. I'm not sure this meetup, but certainly some of the others. Okay. I'm going to get even more controversial. Interview at a company that's hiring DevOps. Interviewing is a skill just like any other skill that you need to practice. Okay? Who has gone to an interview at a company knowing that they are not going to take that job, that they're there for a practice? Yeah, cool. Excellent. Who's been on the receiving end of those people? You bastards, we hate you. Okay? So I find this great. You know, it does go both ways, okay? And I'm not saying that you go and, you know, it's not a deliberate, it's a process that you go through, and it will get you experience. Speak to your manager about making change. Jeez, that's a novel idea. But how many times, I had a team of seven engineers that worked for me at national broadband company. I said to every one of them, I said, if you want to leave, come and speak to me. It's not because I don't like you, because you're shit at your job, it's because I do like you. It's because when you go to leave, I want to know. And I'd like you to do better. I'd like you to move on. So I'm genuinely concerned. Not all managers are like that. But some of us are. So unless you come and speak to me, and so at that organisation, I got one guy promoted into a new team. He took three of my team with him, and he moved in. We formed a new team, but they stayed in the company. We moved another one off to the security team, stayed in the company. So we were able to, progress people through the company, rather than actually. Although we only had one lead, and he went to Toyota, I think, or something like that. Okay, so these are things that you can do. Use your development skills, those are my developers, to help your ops people, to build ops tools. Write test cases. These are fabulous things to have test cases because you people are usually too busy to write things. But if you want to contribute to this process, write test cases. Befriend your local ops guy or developer. So go to the cubicle next and say, I know that, what is it? They say that the developers, they're the blue ones in Star Trek. I'll play this because I'm not a big Star Trek guy. And the ops guys, they're the red shirts, something like that, The blue shirts, that's Mr. Spock. He sits a little bit too close to the boss. He looks a little funny. A little quirky, and the guy in the red shirt, he sits a long way away from the book, but he's always angry. He shouts a lot. Okay? Get cloud experience. Okay? AWS, OpenStack, Azure, Google Cloud, Google Compute. Oh, it should be GCE, shouldn't it? Google Compute Engine, sorry. Sorry? I'm trying not to swear on the video, so that's a four-letter word, IBM, isn't it? IBM Cloud is a four-letter word. If you're a developer, volunteer for that deployment.
Oh, no.
That's out there, isn't it? Okay. Another slide aside, most managers are crap. Okay, they're people just like you. We make mistakes. We sometimes not really good at our job. So it's your career. Don't put it in the hands of your manager, and learn how to manage your manager. So Kate at Velocity did this fabulous talk. Don't know her personally. I call her Kate. Feel it's a bit familiar though, but I can't pronounce her last name. If you want, it's a long talk, it's a Velocity talk, so it's 40 odd minutes. Long. If you skip ahead to 12 minutes and 50 seconds, she explains this process quite well. So, I'd recommend that you go and look at that. I did have a recommended reading list, but I've left that out as well for sort of brevity here. There were some people that have been made redundant. When you leave jobs, don't burn your bridges. This is a very small industry. We mostly know lots of people, or we're only very much removed from each other. So if someone comes to me and says, hey, we're just picking up Phil, you know, he's coming to work at Transurban, sorry Phil, and they come and speak to me, oh, yeah, I worked with him at Odyssey, wanker, don't want him, right? So, you know, he's a good guy. But just be aware of that, it is a small industry. There is no benefit for you to implement a scorched earth policy, okay? And I know some people that do. Not only do they burn it, they squirt lighter fluid on it on the way out, okay? It's extremely satisfying at the time, okay? It's a bit like, you know, your sweet foods. You bring it in, but the high doesn't last for very long, okay? Stay off of social media, okay? You do not want recorded of you venting there. Do it in private. Okay? If you do it in social media, the only one who will look like an idiot is you. Okay? Plus somebody else can look it up, which isn't great. Okay. I'm nearly done. Bear with me. Right. So, these are my tips. Get a professional resume. So we're boiling the whole talk, the last 30 minutes of me rambling here, down to probably 60 seconds. Get a professional resume. Make sure your skills are current with what's in the market. How do we know with what the current skills in the market? Where's my puppet guys? DevOps Survey might tell us what some of the current skills are going on. Yeah. Okay. Community and network involvement. So get involved in the community. And we don't all, you don't have to. That can mean different things to different people. And community just isn't a community of a bunch of technical people. That could be a local tennis club. You could go down there and go, oh yeah, I'm looking for a job, yada yada. Turns out that the, you know, your doubles partner's cousin once removed is the, you know, CEO for IBM Cloud, who just happened to be hiring a whole bunch of people. You know, you might want to go work there. So the network is more. It's more than LinkedIn. It's more than, you know, social media. Educate yourself. Okay, get yourself educated. Whether that's to go to conf, you know, yes, it costs money. It is your career. Okay, I'm guessing that most of you in this room make over $100,000 a year. Apologies to those that don't. Okay. I'm not saying this with a hand. This is not a hands up question, but you know, you can afford to, you know, get out of the hip pocket, splurge a bit of cash. It's tax deductible as well. Can't afford to go and to reinvent? It's all on YouTube. Pick out what you want, and you know what the biggest bonus is? You don't have that long drunken walk back from the bar every night. Okay, so go and get yourself educated. All right. So, oh, did I say who I work for? No. I work for a company called Aconex. Now, you may or may not have heard of them. You should have heard of them because they're probably one of the most successful Melbourne startups in Melbourne. Because they're in Melbourne. It's gone. Yeah. So they've been going for about 15 years. They're a publicly listed company. We do we do software as a service for the production industry, for the construction industry. Interestingly enough, in a report that came out of the US, the only industry that was lower in adopting technology than construction was hunting and fisheries. Okay, so we've got high-tech users. Actually, we're providing them a very good service. So we're doing software as a service for the construction industry. We are hiring. So we'll see how this goes over. I'm looking for a software engineer, a network engineer, a sysadmin. A software engineer, a network engineer, a sysadmin. A software, you get it? Right. I want an iPhone, yeah. okay, didn't quite go over as I wanted. So I'm looking for smart people to do smart things. So if you want to get in touch with me, there are a multitude of different ways. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. Although I do curate my list, so if I do not know who you are, there's a high probability I'll go ignore, like Mr. Venn diagram. He's still on the waiting to connect list. Although, like I said, 14 of my colleagues, 14 of my connections have connected with him. Big Al on Twitter is probably the simplest to remember. We do construction stuff, so I thought the cap with the hat was an appropriate thing. So I feel like I've done all the talking. I'm done. So, does anybody have any questions or want to add anything? Or
yeah, I'll start. You started out by saying you started as a radio engineer.
Yep.
Somehow you got a technical DevOps manager. Something.
How did I get there?
How did you get from yo to wo?
So some people will tell me I'm just lucky. Where I've been at the right place at the right time. I took a chance, you know. So the biggest, what is the saying? I can't remember the words, so I'm going to screw it up. So the biggest sort of investment you can make is in yourself and belief and gamble. So I left the Air Force to take a job as a system admin at the University of South Australia. It was a $30,000 a year pay cut. It was moving from a well-oiled machine that is the military to not to IT, yes, to the dark ages is the basically what it was. I mean, it wasn't a huge leap because I had actually, while I started as a radio technician, avionics, computer-aided fault finding flights. So I worked on computer-aided fault finding for 5 years. And the CPU for that machine was... on a circuit board, that was the CPU. It wasn't a CPU and a chip. It was components, shift registers, all laid down on the board. You're all too old, young to remember that. 32K of ferrite core memory. That was on four circuit boards of similar size. So I did work in this area, and I did coding for that. I worked on flight simulators. I worked in electronic warfare. So, which is quite interesting, where we, I don't know if you want to know the story, too, but basically we buy stuff from the Americans. Let's say we buy F-18s from the Americans. And guess what they're set up to do? They're set up to find, this is a MiG-25, or this is a whatever. Guess what our neighbours close to us that we're interested in what they're doing? They're not flying MiGs, they're flying F-15s. And F-18s are not designed to find F-15s. In fact, they are, and go, friend. So we changed and say, not so friendly. Yeah, left there, went to work for the University of South Australia as a sysadmin. Wrote some code for Mosaic. I did a lot of porting of Mosaic. Who here knows what Mosaic is? Yes, still the old guys. Yeah. Okay. For all the new people, it's, yeah, crime. Okay. So, for you young people. So I wrote some code on how to port that onto Solaris, contributed that. It was well before the days of GitHub, so that's why some of my stuff's not on GitHub. But if you go scour through Usenet patches somewhere, there'll be a patch set that I've contributed to that. What happened there? Went into consulting. So yes, this stuff's good, consulting's good, so I went to work for a consulting company and the IT boom was happening, so right place at the right time. Became a manager there, was an instructor there, went back to management, went back to instructing, went to work for Sun as an instructor, got made redundant from them, was out of work for a long while, went overseas because we could. Just went over and see, as a fact, we went overseas and we didn't have a job. We just went, well, what's the worst thing that can happen? Well, we have to move back home and move in with our parents. And I'm not sure whether that's worse for them or worse for us. So, you know, got jobs there, worked at Royal Bank of Scotland, it was still a functioning bank when I left, by the way. They hadn't gone bust, that's not my fault. worked in Switzerland, met people, met a guy in RBS, was a really, really quirky fellow. It's a long story, so I can't tell it here. Got me a job in Zurich, went to Zurich, eventually came back to Australia and sort of, I don't know, just progressed. Just progressed. Yep. Yep. I'm contracted, basically. If you're enjoying the job and it's giving you the challenge, then I wouldn't want to change jobs. So I spent 12 years working for the Air Force. Effectively, I had the same employer, but I worked at different places within inside that, so that gave me the opportunity. I didn't want to be senior NCO in charge of refueling Hornets at Rathbase Tyndall, which is the arse end of nowhere. It's halfway between Darwin and Alice Springs. And that didn't appeal to me, so I left. I went into mainstream IT. So this is my opinion. Yeah, so there are certain companies that I would probably not look for people from, for various reasons. I'm just going to stay completely diplomatic, as you know, as I may need a job with them, although I flamed Oracle this morning, so I've written them off. So, there would be. Look, if you'd spent, you know, 20 years at IBM, but you had, you know, 10 different roles within there, then, you know, that knows you grow through there. But if you're in the same job doing the same thing day in, day out, you know, that doesn't say to me that you're, you know, inspired or, you know, looking to challenge yourself. Probably. Yeah. And so one of the things when you're going through an agency, and sorry, I'm gonna malign you here, but I could have just gone, you know, we hate recruiters, let's be honest. It doesn't mean we can't have a beer together though. So the easiest path is to plug that hole with someone that already fits. So if someone already has those skills, it's easy for me to just go, yes, you can fill that hole, you can fill that hole. I don't know about you, but when I move, I'm looking for my next challenge. I'm looking for what new things I can learn and experience and those types of things. And if I'm looking, so if today you're looking to move into somewhere that wants to do something cool and funky with, you know, container orchestration, for example, then you may not be doing that at, you know, at IBM today. Oracle, insert any of the big branded companies, but you're going to have to learn a little bit about that before you can move into that job. So you're going to have to educate yourself. You're going to have to go into an interview, and yes, I know what Kubernetes is. Yes, I know. I was here, look at this little project I did where I put a bunch of Raspberry Pis together and did Kubernetes stuff on it or whatever. You know, it shows an issue. Shows that you want to do stuff. There was something else I was going to say on that. I'll come back to you for a second. I just interviewed a guy the other week, and he said it was always his career aspirations to go and work for a large IT organization like Hewlett Packard and IBM. And he had. And I said to him, how did that work out? He said, I wouldn't be here had it. Sorry.
When do you think, or if you think, DevOps will stop the playing this thing, you know, this thing on the side and just become
satisfied? So there are some of us who say we've been doing DevOps for 30 years, or DevOps is just a 1990s Sysadmin where you actually had to do all this in the 90s. I don't know. I, to me, it's going to be here for a while. I see it as it's probably, if I, you know, I'm not great at predicting stuff. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here talking to you guys. I'd be selling myself on the beach somewhere. I used to work at Sportsbet. So someone knows where I used to be. Otherwise, I'd be selling myself on a beach because I would have made a lot of money in predictions. But I would probably go, it's going to travel the same way as Agile or some similar types of methodologies, would be my opinion. But it will be, and I actually think, if I was to put a stake in the ground, I say within 12 months, you know, if you are not someone, but DevOps, the trouble is that DevOps to you is different to DevOps to Andrew, to Simon, to Phil. It's all different. So it all means different things, but I do believe it within 12 months it will become. If you don't have that or you can't work in that kind of environment, then you're going to struggle. You're going to be stuck at some of the utilities companies or something like that.
Sorry.
Yep. What do you think the most important challenge is in that cultural shift that still needs working?
One lot is responsible for adding stuff and changing things. The other one is I do not want to change anything because I want maximum stability. And I get maximum stability by not changing anything. So that's a huge hurdle to overcome. As an operations guy, you're gold on you're not gold on number of releases per day. You're gold on percentage uptime. What's detrimental percentage uptime? Releases. So don't do them. So that's probably going to be the biggest sort of challenge of working together to how we can actually make releases have and not a negative effect on your line and having these people accountable both in the same goal and not two different groups with two different targets because I'm going to achieve that.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry. Conflicting KPIs. Yeah.
So, you mentioned sort of super generalist. Is there anything you don't need to know as a DevOps engineer?
I don't even know how to make dinner. Someone else can do that. Don't need to know. I'd say the more you know, sort of the better, but you can get to the stage where you're too spread too thin. So I think we're going to find that, you know, as it's in the room here, you've got people that will call themselves DevOps engineers that come from a development background and have a completely different skill set to those that come from an administration background, but they can still be DevOps engineers and they can still talk to each other. And you've got to be mindful that you don't want to take on things. Did anyone see the post this morning that coding has now been added to the Victorian education curriculum? I wasn't even aware it wasn't on the curriculum. I cannot believe that in 2017 you could go through and come out of high school and not know how to code. I was like, wow. So, that is a key skill that a lot of us sysadmins don't have. A lot of developers don't have either. But it's, about half the audience have left, so I'm sufficiently bored. Other people, unless there's any more questions, I'll sorry.
Yep. Just a tough question.
Yeah.
Do you know what a concrete to lake next?
I don't know. I wouldn't think so. So yeah, it's a document sharing. Service you can do. We're now doing price variations and pricing stuff, so people can do this new feature is 3D modeling has been added. So that's the BIM team. So if anyone's interested in 3D modeling, the BIM stuff is that's a big thing that's happening for us at the moment. All the guys have been working on for some time. So yeah, you'll see how the construction industry is a competitor. You could work on the cubicle next to me, I don't even know.
that's it. Please join me in thanking Alan.